Cass. By late morning, all the tuna casserole has been successfully scraped out of the microwave, and the living room has been sloppily painted a ghastly off-white color, so Sinatra and I sit on a couple of 5-gallon paint buckets in front of the open front door of 105, eating great popsicles and watching the rain sizzle off the steamy concrete sidewalk. "And what's that one?" I ask, continuing a game we've been playing all morning where he shows off his knowledge of all the tools in my bag. "An angle grinder," he says, with a hint of duh in his tone. "Okay then, smarty pants. What is this called and why?" "It's a Phillips head. It's named after the inventor," he responds, which is something I didn't know, but of course he does. "My mom used to have me open her wine bottles with one of those," he adds, and I give him a blank stare, trying to imagine how one would do such a thing. "She didn't have an opener sometimes, so I'd just push the cork down into the bottle." He says this like that's a normal thing kids do for their alcoholic jailbird mothers. "Ah," is all I can think to say. I see Eddie cross the pool deck, pulling his ball cap down to shield himself from the rain, and then picking up a slow jog until he reaches the tin awning his truck is parked beneath. The guy always seems to be fixing his pickup, yet it never seems to be fixed. He just pokes at it and spends a bunch of time on his phone between constant visits from a few of his sketchy-looking friends. Maybe nobody else notices how odd it is, but he parks in view of the front office, so I see it. I see the friends with their backpacks and sunglasses, who never stay too long and shake hands with each other a freakish amount. I wonder if he's selling pot or something, handing off dime bags to these guys. Man, if he is up to no good, maybe he'll be even more scared when I show him the video I have. Maybe he has more to lose than I thought. I need to make my move today. For Rosa, "Hey, Sinatra, how about if you finish up sweeping and mopping and take this garbage to the dumpster? I buy you McDonald's for dinner," I say, and his eyes light up as he gets to his feet. "Really?" he says, and I am starting to get the feeling that crappy McNuggets are the best thing to happen to this kid in a long time, and it sort of breaks my heart. "I'll do a good job," he says, collecting the popsicle wrappers and dragging the trash bag outside the front door. "I know you will. What's your favorite at Mickey D's?" I ask him. "Whatever you like, whatever you think," he says eagerly, and my heart swells a little. I resist the urge to hug him. Resist the draw to try to erase whatever it is he went through that made scraping tuna casserole out of a microwave the highlight of his week. Instead, I say, "See, you gotta watch out there, Sinatra. What if I got the Filet-O-Fish? Let me tell ya, they put cheese on it. Fish and cheese don't go together. It's sick and wrong." "That's okay," he says, "if you like it. How about a happy meal and one of those lava hot apple pies that destroy the roof of your mouth?" I ask, and he nods vigorously. "Cool. I gotta go do some stuff, so just come by the office around dinner time," I say, and he's already starting to sweep the patch of linoleum in the depressingly tiny scrap of galley kitchen in the apartment. Grandma Mary says dinner time is when Murder, She Wrote comes on, and she can start to defrost her lean cuisine, but I don't know what time that is. "Anytime you want, how about that?" I say, hoisting my tool bag over my shoulder and walking out into the rain. "I have to help Grandma Mary with her pills at dinner time," he says. "Oh, well then, lunch. Late lunch. Just stop in a couple hours." "Okay," Frank beams and waves as I leave and then gets to work sweeping, and I feel my chest tighten upon leaving him, and I don't know why. But I keep my eyes on Eddie Bacco leaning on his truck, and I try to think of how to lure him into the front office without anyone really noticing. By noon, the rain has dissipated, and the humidity is suffocating, and I spin back and forth in the office chair, keeping an eye on Eddie outside, but not knowing exactly what to do, what I'll say. I figure if it's technically afternoon, maybe offering him a beer will seem normal. It's Friday, after all. The residents always get together and grill by the pool on Friday evenings. I can tell him I bought a bunch of beer for the Friday potluck, and does he want one 'cause he looks hot? That's not creepy, I think he'd bite. But just then, one of his weird friends shows up and they talk in whispers, and I can't hear what they're saying. So I decide to walk outside the front door to the mailbox block and act like I'm inserting notices into a couple mailboxes, but they stop talking when they see me. I notice a few packages for a couple residents that are too big to fit in the mailbox, so I walk one package over to 207 and drop it off. The other is Callum's, and since I know he's teaching summer school today, I pull it into the office and text him to pick it up. The friend is finally gone, and it's now or never. I think I'm doing the right thing. Vigilante justice. Guys like him can't get away with this shit, so he needs to know someone is watching. At least this is what I tell myself, but my hands tremble violently. I take in a deep breath and try to steady them as I pick up two Bud Lights and walk outside. "Oh, hey, Eddie," I say, and I can hear my voice shake, so I clear my throat. "It's hot as hell out here, eh?" He nods and wipes the sweat from his forehead with a cloth that he shoves back into his jeans pocket. "You want a beer? I bought a bunch for later, but it's that time of day." I look at my wrist at a watch that's not there and say, "Beer o'clock." God, I sound like a moron. "If you want to cool off a minute." He looks around like someone might be pulling a prank on him and then shrugs and walks toward me. "Yeah, okay," he says, and I nod back and slip in the office door. I made sure all the blinds were closed so nobody would see me threaten him. I mean, I have done this many times before with more dangerous people than him, and it always worked out. I'm not even exploiting him for money this time. Of course, doing this in the middle of the night would be ideal, just like I did with the others, but I don't have access to him then. I just need to do it. I remind myself that I have the upper hand, and I'm doing the right thing and to stay calm. The office is dim with the blinds closed, and it feels icy cold after stepping in from the sweltering heat. It's awkwardly quiet, just the hum of the air conditioner and a low rumble of thunder in the distance. He looks uncomfortable and like he's regretting his decision as he takes the beer from my outstretched hand. He drops his bag on the dusty coffee table covered in People magazines from God knows how many years ago. It's just about then that he registers how awkward this is. "Well, thanks. But I better go, I got a trip," he says, moving toward his bag. "Oh, you're a truck driver, right? Big rig?" I ask, but he doesn't answer. "That must be hard. How long you gone?" He gives me the oddest look and then says, "Couple of weeks, I better get going." "I thought your car was broken down," I say, nodding in the general direction of his perpetually broken pickup in the parking lot. "How do you get to the lot? Is that where you pick it up? There's probably a warehouse or a truck lot, right?" God, I can't stop rambling. He picks up his bag and moves to the door. "I have a ride." Most days, the door to the office is propped open, and Barry is sitting on the worn leather sofa chatting away about swords or some mundane thing or another, or Crystal, who refuses to pay for internet, is at my desk checking her social media and smoking, or Babs is shaking up martinis for everyone. It really does feel like I live in a college dormitory half the time, and I'm the raw with a revolving door, but today it's quiet and empty and not what he was expecting when he walked in here. I can tell that he feels the energy shift and again thanks me for the drink, and he hoists his bag onto his shoulder. "Wait," I say quickly. He stops and turns to me. "I have something to show you," I say, and I guess he thinks it's sexual maybe, because the look on his face is one of surprise mixed with intrigue. He drops his bag again and walks over to me. "Oh yeah, what's that?" he asks with a smirk on his face. I turn my phone to him and play the video of him and Rosa in the laundry room, the yelling, his raised voice. I watch him look at the phone, his head cocked, shock spreading across his face. The phone is facing away from me as I show him, so I don't see him strike her, but I hear it and study his reaction as she falls to the ground. Fury, I think that's what I see. Red blotches dot his chest and face, and his eyes narrow, but he's silent. The video stops. He just stares at me with a look that frightens the shit out of me, like he could attack at any second. I just want you to leave her alone, I say, and the words sound confident, but I'm backing up and shakily shoving my phone into my pocket. Or, is all he says, a terrifying coldness behind his eyes. Or I show this to the cops, get you kicked out of here or arrested. I'm watching you is all I'm saying, so be a man and don't hit women. That's all, I say, feeling my courage returning with these words, because I'm right, and he's the one who's wrong here. I fold my arms in front of me to emphasize my point. I backed up the video, I add quickly, in case he thinks of trying to take my phone. So really, what's he gonna do? It's broad daylight, and I have a security camera in the corner, pointed right at him, although he doesn't know I switched it off to ensure nobody ever sees this. People come in and out of here all the time. He's not gonna freak out or try to take my phone if he knows what's good for him. I'm sorry, he says, so calmly the hair on the back of my neck stands up and chills tap across my shoulders and down my back. Who the fuck do you think you are exactly? Someone who isn't gonna let guys like you get away with that shit, I respond, and then it happens. He rushes me in a white-hot rage with blind hatred in his eyes, so quickly I can't even move or react and slams me up against the wall so hard it knocks the wind out of me, and I gasp for breath. But I can't get any air in because he's squeezing my neck with both hands. I can feel a drop of blood slither from the back of my head onto my shoulder, and I see an explosion of stars behind my eyes. I know everything is about to go black if I don't inhale in a matter of seconds. My arms flail, and I claw and grab at anything on the desk next to me that's within reach. I can't see anything, so I just blindly feel and pray for something there that I can defend myself with anything I can hit him with and escape his grasp. You thought you could blackmail me? He laughs and I try to kick at him, but I don't have enough oxygen. My body feels numb. The room spins. I am going to lose consciousness. I clutch something from the desk next to me. I hook the handle with the ends of my fingertips, just barely. It's a pair of scissors. I can't see him. Everything is a blur. So I just blindly grab them with the little strength I have left and stab at him to get him off me. I feel his grip loosen, and I fall to the floor. I still can't see. Everything is swirls and stars, and I'm so lightheaded I can barely push myself to stand, to run, and then finally my breath starts to steady, and I look up to see him standing there with wide eyes and an open mouth. I scurry backward across the floor to move away, and I stand and lean against the wall, still steadying my dizzy head with my hands, and then I see it, I realize why he's stopped choking me and is standing impossibly still. The scissors are plunged into the side of his neck, and blood is seeping out of the corners of his mouth. I think a sound like a scream escapes my lips, but I can't be sure. The shock paralyzes me for a few moments as I grip the wall behind me and try to catch my breath. I watch him pull the scissors from his neck and hold the wound, but the blood spills over the top of his hand, and then he stiffens. His eyes bulge, and his gaze is fixed straight ahead. His mouth falls open, and he collapses to the polished concrete floor with a crack so loud, bones must have snapped as he smacked the surface. He goes completely limp. Dark blood slowly pools around his head, and his body twitches before it goes still again. I cup both my hands over my mouth so I don't scream, but the sobs can't be suppressed. What have I done? Fuck, fuck, fuck. What have I done? I rush to him and stand over his body, trying not to hyperventilate. I rest my hands on my knees and drop my head. Holy shit. The blood travels in tiny rivers across the concrete floor and pools against the braided area rug under the coffee table, creating a horrifying blaze of red against the white wool. Oh God, what did I do? Just then, I hear a tap-tap at the office door, and a voice calls. Cass? You there? Shit. It's Callum. I told him to come and get his package. I snap up to standing and look to the door, thinking I can run and lock it before he comes in. I need time. I need. But before I can even take one step toward it, the doorknob turns and Callum pokes his head in. Hello. You told me I had a... He steps inside and sees me hunched over a bleeding body, and he freezes. I hear a sharp intake of breath as he holds his hand to his heart and looks to me, then to Eddie lying lifeless beneath me, then back to me, and we lock eyes. "I didn't mean to," I cry. I rush past him to the door and slam it shut behind Callum, locking it and standing in front of it with tears streaming down my face. It was an accident. Oh God, what have I done? Anna. In the blackness, I sit near the entrance door where a slit of daylight cuts through the dark, and after a few hours of slamming my fist against it and calling for help, exhaustion takes over and I give up. All I can do now is cry quietly and pray that someone finds me. The rain has stopped now, and it's quiet. The earthy damp smell in this dungeon of a room makes me want to retch, and my hatred for this place boils inside of me. My phone rings from inside Henry's unit, and I can't see the screen, but the light illuminates the darkness. I quickly look around to see if there is anything in sight I can use to climb up to the egress window or tools I can break the handle off the door with, but the ringing stops, and it's dark again. A few moments later, I hear footsteps coming down the sidewalk. This storage unit is tucked away behind the main buildings, so nobody comes back here, it seems, unless they are actually coming to the storage area. I feel the wall and rise to my feet. I beat on the door again. "Hello, is someone there?" And the door swings open. A figure is backlit by blinding sunlight, and for a moment, I wonder if it's someone who's come to hurt me. If I've actually been kidnapped or taken captive or something. It's this thought that makes me cower and back up instead of throwing my arms around the person and thanking them. "Anna," the man says, "it's Barry, the annoying guy from 206. He sounds more surprised than someone who's come to kill me would, I think, but I can't be certain yet. Did you lock me in here?" I ask shakily. Then he steps in, and I can see him clearly without the sun in my eyes. "Oh my God, you were locked in here?" "No, God, I sold a sword." "What?" I ask, thinking for a moment he's messing with me, trying to confuse me, because he doesn't make sense. "I keep my collection in my storage unit. Sometimes I sell them on eBay." "God, I'm so sorry. How in the world did you get stuck down here?" "Someone locked me in," I say, blinking back tears that are partly relief, but still terror and confusion. "No, nobody would do that. The wind was really going there for a while. I'm sure it just." "I saw someone do it," I say firmly. He doesn't seem to know how to respond. He runs his hands through his hair and gestures to the door. "Well, gosh, let's get you out of here," he says, and I don't know if I should trust him. Is he a psychopath who is going to strangle me and stuff my body in a plastic storage bin if I get close? I feel like a trapped animal. I keep looking at the triangle of light from the door behind him and wonder if I should try to make a run for it. What has this place done to me? Maybe he's just getting his whatever from his storage unit, and I've lost it. I have to get my phone, and I need to bring these boxes up to my apartment, I say, hoping he moves away from the door. "Oh gosh, let me help you," he says, and then he goes right to Henry's unit. There is a flood of relief that he's moved from the doorframe and his defenses are down, and I could run out and lock him in if I had to. A question pops into my mind. How does he know which unit is Henry's? Why would he? I stand outside the door and gulp in the fresh air. I should tell him he doesn't have to help, but I'm not going back in there if I don't have to, and now that I'm out and safe, I let him. He tells me we'll have to clip the wire door open in order to reach in and get the key, but that'll take some tools. My impatience boils as I wait for him to call Cass about some sort of industrial clippers or whatever he's talking about. "No answer," he says, "but she won't mind if we break it open. You need your keys. The thing's on its last leg anyway." He goes to his unit where a dozen swords hang on display in a very off-putting way. He plucks one of the curved swords with an emerald green handle from its place on a shelf and swipes at the rusty square that the lock attaches to on the unit door. It easily comes loose from the screw and falls to the floor. All the while I'm watching this from outside the main door, still shaky and ready to run if he suddenly decides to try to dismember me with one of his swords, which I haven't ruled out as a possibility quite yet. But then he smiles and does some weird court jester bow with a hand flourish, as if he's mastered a great feat, leans his sword against a wooden beam, and begins helping me pull out boxes. "Thank you," I say as he hoists a couple of boxes up on his shoulder. He hands me my phone as he passes me, then continues on to bring them up to my apartment door. Although I finally feel like I'm safe from being murdered, I don't offer to help. Maybe I am overreacting, and someone did just close the door so the room didn't flood and ruin people's things they didn't hear me because the thundering rain was so loud. That's possible, and Barry is probably actually just trying to help. Occam's razor, I can hear my dad saying, is the philosophy that the simplest explanation is usually correct, or something like that. Still, I rush up to my apartment and pull the boxes inside as Barry sets them down on my doormat, keeping my distance. I look at my phone, but there's just a text from my mother checking in and two missed calls from my friend Monica. Nothing from Callum telling me he got my message and will be careful. I watch Barry labor up the stairs with a heavy box of books, and I'm grateful, but I also can't shake the feeling that there's something off about him. He's an attractive guy, and if you just saw him, you'd lump him in as a popular guy in school and someone with a few special lady friends who works in a cubicle and plays golf on the weekend. But when he talks, he's, I don't know, almost childlike, too eager to help, missing that chip most people have that should tell him when he's talking too close or overstaying his welcome. He's just oddly clueless, I guess, is the best way to describe it. Maybe harmless, maybe not. When he's brought up the last box, I offer to pay him for his time because I have to offer him something, and I'm not inviting him in. Oh gosh, no way. I'm so sorry for what you went through. I'm just here to help. Before I can respond, I hear a voice say, "Girl," and Barry and I both turn and look down to see a woman with white capri pants and heels with a silk blouse and a single string of pearls around a very delicate neck. It's Monica. She's shielding her eyes from the sun with one hand and the other is on her hip. "I've been calling for ages. I was going to Paradiso's for brunch and wanted you to come. You don't answer your phone anymore," she asks as she navigates the wet pool deck in heels and makes her way to the staircase to come up. Barry pats my arm and tells me to call if I need anything else before he leaves. "Hi," I say, hugging her tightly when she enters the door to the apartment. "Sorry, I..." And then I stop and decide not to tell her that I was locked in a dungeon for hours, probably by a psychopath who's out to get me, and that I feel like I'm losing my mind here. I'm glad to see my oldest friend, but all I want right now is to shower off the last few hours and then bawl into my pillow for a good while before I can absorb one more thing today. Wow, Anna? Yikes. This was his studio. God, I imagined some Joanna Gaines shit going on. It sounded romantic, like a loft with exposed brick and soaring 20-foot vaulted ceilings with beams. God, is that a popcorn ceiling? What the hell? "I don't know," I say. "I thought the same thing when he showed it to me last year, but if this is how he got his inspiration, who am I to judge?" "It shouldn't be that shocking. I mean, it sort of is. He probably could have rented the kind of artist loft with a cityscape view she's describing, but he's known for gritty portraits, real people, unfiltered. This place meant something to him for reasons I can't understand, but for reasons that were his own, that I can at least accept. I feel protective of him when someone doubts him like this, and she should know that." "Sorry," she says, pulling a bottle of champagne from her oversized coach tote. "Just..." She looks around with raised brows. "Not what I expected. But hey, I brought brunch to you. Thought you could use it." She smooths her sleek black hair with her hand nervously and looks around like every surface is too disgusting to place her bag down. She can come off a bit. I don't know, crass, direct maybe. Is that the word? But I know her enough to know that acting like things are normal and we can drink through any problem is key. talking aimlessly about the everyday mundane and ignoring the impossible, traumatizing reality is the way you get through hard times, and sometimes that's just the kind of friend you need, one who won't ask you how you feel. Not because she doesn't care, but as a very purposeful strategy to keep you in good spirits and distracted. It might not be what I need right now, but a mimosa and idle conversation about her new hair stylist, who does stellar lowlights, but who's sadly moving to Lake Havasu. And what is she going to do is going to keep me from losing it right now. So we pull out a wooden chair from the small kitchen nook and set it up next to the ugly metal chair on the balcony and sit, drinking warm bubbly and sunnied out of Dixie cups. Below us, some of the pool girls are already bringing out a folding table and taping a dollar store plastic cover over it, where they place sleeves of solo cups and hot dog buns and other prep for the Friday evening barbecue. Monica must be stunned into silence by the place because her lips are pursed and her eyes are darting around. She swats away a fly as if even that is a product of this filthy place and would never have bothered her somewhere more posh. "So you live here now?" she asks. "No, I mean, I'm just going through all his stuff, and it was paid up for the next month, so why not take my time while the house sells?" "Then where? You know you can stay with me and Stephen, right? I mean, his mother is there now, ugh, but just for another week, thank Christ." She told Katie her Barbies were dressed like whores and then ordered colonial prairie dresses for them. Can you believe they even make those? Now Katie's playing Amish Village or Little House on the Prairie or whatever the hell she's doing out there, because her dolls rough it in the backyard now and she wants to sell Barbie's dream house for a decent profit, Christ. "So I mean, if you need realtor referrals or anything," she says, and I smirk at this. "But really," she continues, "if you don't want to go back to your house, we have the pool house. It's private. You can stay as long as you want." "Well, thanks. I'm still figuring out what I want to do." I don't tell her I still dream of just leaving and wandering the world and not buying another suburban house and not begging for a mid-level, soul-stealing journalism job I'll get turned down for anyway. I just need to sort through everything here, and I just need to figure out what happened, I say, willing my voice not to break. "Tell me, you know, like really, really know that what he did was not about you. He was depressed. I mean, I just hope you don't blame yourself or—" "No, I know," I say, cutting her off, and actually forgetting for just a moment that nobody else knows it was foul play. I can't tell her. I can't even say the words out loud. I just need to know more before I start to publicize this and then subsequently drown in the pity and questions and unsolicited advice. I need to stay clear and focused. For Henry. The whoosh and sputter of a match being lit behind Monica's head makes her whip around in her chair and spill a splash of mimosa onto her blouse. "The fuck," she yelps. "Oh hey, ladies, it's Babs." She wears a pink housecoat and yellow flip-flops. She inhales deeply on her cigarette and smiles at us. "Jesus," Monica says, likely out of shock at the woman's appearance. She looks to me for an explanation, then back to Babs. "Smoke?" Babs asks. Monica shakes her head and looks to me again with raised eyebrows. Babs leans over the railing, releasing a hearty cough that somehow turns into a laugh. She gestures with her cigarette. "Little Kevin pooped in the pool again." We look down to see very pregnant Crystal crying as she tries to fish it out with a tiny butterfly net and simultaneously screaming at Tiffany and Amber to get out of the pool, but they are both gleefully trying to cannonball themselves on top of it. "They're gonna get the pink eye," Babs says. Monica stands wide-eyed, with her heart to her chest. "You new here?" Babs asks. "I'm Uncle Fester. Welcome." She holds her hand out for Monica to shake, but Monica mumbles, "Excuse me," and backs up until she bumps into my apartment door, then slips inside. "No," I say, "she's not a tenant. Just a friend who stopped by." Before I can go inside behind Monica, Babs asks, "You warn Callum about Eddie? Haven't seen either of them today. Just saying." I did, yeah, I say, and then start toward my door. You ain't gonna drink this, she asks, picking up my half-empty mimosa cup. All yours. Gotta run. In the short time I've been here, the strangeness of the place has almost begun to feel normal somehow, and then I see how Monica looks at it with fresh eyes and question again if I should just go. Just give all his things away. Donate the paintings, call the Salvation Army to do a pickup for the rest, and get on the next plane to a beach. Fucking anywhere, really. It's very tempting, but when I stand looking at the towering boxes of his whole life, I can't do that. I'd always regret not trying to figure it out, understand what happened to my sweet Henry. Then a terrifying thought hits me. What if I can't leave town? It seems like they think I'm a suspect. What if this goes on for years and my life is destroyed even more than it is already? I'm gonna find the truth, goddammit. There have to be answers in between all these pages of books and photos and scribblings. What are you doing? I ask Monica as she opens and closes cupboards in the kitchenette. Looking for booze. This place requires vodka, not champagne. What the actual fuck? There are only four cupboards, so she finds Henry's minibar pretty quickly. She washes a martini glass caked in dust that I can't imagine Henry even having, let alone using, and pours Seagram's and expired Cran apple juice into it. She perches on a stool, sipping her drink, and takes the place in. Does Henry still have Laura's Pam stashed away? I could use one. How are you staying here? She asks, and I stop rifling through the box I've picked up and look at her a moment. How would she know Henry had Laura's Pam? It strikes me as odd, but there's probably an easy explanation. I can help, you know, she says. Help? I can go through the boxes with you. We'll order delivery from Giovanni's, and there's enough booze, so yeah. I just need some sweats. These are Dior. She brushes her hands across her white pants. I think about this a minute. She doesn't know what we're looking for. Hell, I don't know what we're looking for. Certainly not a confession note from the murderer, signed and notarized in one of the boxes. I'll know it when I see it if it's important, but there's no harm in having her help. She thinks I'm just sorting it out for keep and donation piles. It would be nice, actually. Who wants to do this alone? We order a cheese lovers and mix martinis, and Monica is smart enough to play some neutral television show in the background, a PBS detective show, nothing that could cause me to spontaneously bawl like most songs will do these days. And we sit on the floor and start to pull off crinkly tape and rifle through endless kitsch and clutter. Mostly old textbooks, art supplies, and unframed canvases stored in neat piles with sheets of bubble wrap in between. I pack the mundane items back into the boxes they came from, give them a Sharpie X on top, and move those in front of the kitchen counter to stay organized. After a couple hours of this, Monica is lying on the floor scrolling with her phone over her face, and I'm already tiring of this myself. What the hell am I even looking for? Across the room, a handful of paintings catch my eye, so I cross to them and pluck out the one he painted of Monica. Oh, I always loved this one, I say, touching its rough surface, remembering Henry painting Monica at a cookout we had by the lake with a few couples from church. Oh God, look how fat I was. I look like I swallowed a Christmas ham. You were pregnant, I say. Still, she says. I smile at the portrait of her in a blue sundress with her hand on her belly, looking out at the sparkling water. I love it, I say, then I perch on the edge of the couch and cut open a few bigger boxes, nothing but drop cloths and brushes. Well, you have to keep these, they were his favorite, Monica says, handing me a stack of old LP records. I take them and flip through Nat King Cole, Dean Martin, Glenn Miller. I feel my cheeks go hot and red when she says this. If these were his favorites, I would know that. How does she know that? He only played them for dinner party night because it made him seem sophisticated. What is happening right now? Dean Martin especially, right? Cooking bad pasta and singing, "You're nobody till somebody loves you," into a wooden spoon. She laughs, sort of singing along with the melody a moment, then stops cold. Sorry, God, I can't imagine how hard this must be. Shit, sorry, she says, but it's not that. It's just, where is she getting this from? I've seen Henry sing Dean Martin into a wooden spoon cooking dinner, but when has she? It doesn't make sense to me, but I'm probably just losing it in general with everything going on and not recalling. There could have been a dozen times he did this when I was pouring drinks for guests on the patio, for all I know. I'm being ridiculous, and I'm becoming delusional. I really need to keep it together. I'm okay, yeah, we'll keep these. I tuck them into a keep pile behind the sofa and take a sip of my martini. I need a break from this. She's mindlessly shaking out an old leather-bound book on the floor, the way we've been doing all afternoon, looking for any tucked-away photos we might miss, and then she turns it back over and flips through a few of the pages. Suddenly, I see her face fall. She closes the book and stares at the cover, then opens it again, then quickly shoves it into a box next to her. What? I snap. What? She makes a terrible attempt at pretending she didn't see something upsetting. Shit, is all she says. What? I walk over, and she stands as if to stop me. Monica, seriously, what the hell? It's a journal, I think. Unless he writes fiction. Does he write fiction at all? Maybe? Probably? He wrote some poetry. We met in a poetry class in college, you know that. Not. Why? What? Oh God, yes, that's probably what it is then. That makes sense. Forget about it. Old bad poetry. She tries to force a laugh, but I snatch the book and carry it to the couch. I open it, perched on my knees, and search for what she saw that made that look fall across her face, and it only takes seconds to see. It's written in one form or another on every page. Oh God. My hand flies to my mouth. Honey, maybe there's an explanation, like, this is not poetry, this is. I stand. I can't catch my breath. My face feels numb. My hands are shaking. I gotta go, I blurt, grabbing my keys. Sorry, I gotta get out of here right now. Okay, she says. I get it. She quickly grabs her bag, leaves her heels and mimosa supplies, and follows me out. Then I lock the door and just run. I'm sorry, I say again as I bolt to my car, and I have no idea where I'm going. For a brief moment, I want to run to Callum, and I don't understand why. His car is here, but all of his lights in his apartment are off, so I don't bother him. I just drive. I just let the tears fall and beat the steering wheel with my fists and speed through the winding desert roads until I can figure out where to go. How could you leave me with this? What have you done, Henry? Cass. What the hell happened? Callum says breathlessly as he runs to Eddie's side and kneels down. I stumble backward in shock because at first it looks like he's embracing the man or something, but it's not the reaction I expected. Then I see he's gone into autopilot and is performing CPR. I've never seen anyone do this in real life, and it's actually really violent, the forced breathing, the pumps on Eddie's chest with his full body weight. There's a pile of pool towels for the kids stacked up on a shelf, and he's grabbed one to try to stop the bleeding. I don't say that there's no point to all this. Words won't come at all. I sit on the sofa and bury my head in my hands, and I want to cover my ears so I don't hear the sounds he's making, and I want to scream. Instead, I sob quietly into my palms. After a few minutes, it's still, and I look up to see Callum slumped against the wall next to the body. Jesus, he whispers. He's covered in Eddie's blood. It's around his mouth, the side of his face, streaked down his white polo shirt. He's gone. I continue to cry, quietly at first, then in uncontrollable hiccuped sobs. I try to explain what happened, but have trouble catching my breath. He tried to kill me. What? He says, and I watch him take in the room, the scissors on the floor next to the desk, the marks on my neck. It's my fault, I know, but It was an accident. He was choking me, Callum. You have to believe me. I was defending myself. he. I trail off, not knowing what to say, the trauma of it all still making my head swim. Oh my God, why, Callum says, pushing himself up from the floor and sitting across from me. He stares, fear and confusion in his eyes. He picks up a cloth from the table and wipes the blood from his face, shaking his head in disbelief and looking down at himself where Eddie's blood has soaked through his shirt. He looks like he's in shock. Were you mixed up with him? He asks me. Mixed up with him? No. What does that mean? I don't even. Drugs. Did you buy from him? Why was he after you? Drugs, I say, pulling up the hem of my tank top to wipe my wet cheeks. So you don't know who he is then? God, Callum, you're not making any sense. I stand now, pacing. I know who he is. It's fucking Eddie. You know Eddie, the idiot from 103. I found out he was hitting Rosa like abusing her, so I recorded it. On my phone one night, so I showed him. Just now, I said I'd turn him in if he didn't leave her alone. That's it. Oh, Jesus, he says. Now he's the one cradling his head in his hands. What? I'll tell the police the truth that it was. I can explain that he had me by the throat. I try to keep talking, but I lose my breath, and my cries are mixed with shrieks for air as I panic again when it all starts to settle in. Oh my God. Does anyone else have keys to the office? He asks, and I shake my head, but I don't know why he's asking. And both doors are locked, he says, walking around and checking the locks, smoothing down the closed blinds. Then he stops cold and points to the security camera above the desk with wide eyes. Besides the owners who live in Phoenix, no residents. Why? And both doors are locked, he says, walking around and checking the locks, smoothing down the closed blinds. Then he stops cold and points to the security camera above the desk with wide eyes. Off, I say. Why? Everyone's gonna know anyway when I call it in. We have to call them now, or they'll think I'm hiding something lying. They can tell that shit, you know. How long someone's been. Oh my God, I'm a murderer. I say, and before I can break down again, he stops me. He puts his finger to his lips for me to keep it down. He sits on the couch and looks at Eddie's pack. I sit opposite him, rocking, keeping my cries hushed, shaking my head over and over in disbelief. Listen, I need you to stay calm, okay? But we're fucked. So just try to stay quiet, and I'm going to explain something to you, he says. And he's beginning to terrify me almost more than the weight of what I've just done. This guy isn't just dangerous, not just connected to a dozen people who could have us both decapitated and left in a Mexican desert tomorrow, he's cartel. And if I'm right about all this, we're beyond fucked if anyone connects us to this. You're not making sense. You're freaking me out, and you're not even making any goddamn sense. First, how the hell would you know that? And you didn't even do anything. You just tried to help, so you're fine. I'm the one who's fucked. Everyone watched me threaten him by the pool. His blood is all over me. Literally, and shit. I searched him. I was tipped off he might be. That I should be careful, so I looked him up. Online, you know. It was a half day at school, and when the students left, I learned all about the guy on a public school computer. Fuck. Fuwuk. So what? So fucking what? What the hell are you talking about? If he's that dangerous, then he's dead, and the cops will see who he was believe it was an accident that I was threatened. Good. That's good, right? It's not the cops we need to worry about, he says, and I stand and begin to pace the floor with my hands over my eyes and my head tilted to the ceiling and try to calm down, try to take in what he's telling me. I don't know what that means. See, I finally say, grabbing Eddie's bag. I start to dump out Eddie's things all over the dusty coffee table. He's a long-haul trucker. It's all maps and porn and Red Bulls. I start to rant manically but stop. We both freeze when we see what actually falls out on the table, a gallon bag with many smaller, taped-up bags full of white powder and three stacks of $100 bills bound in rubber bands. Oh God, oh God, oh God. I start to panic. I stand, then sit, then stand again and go to the office chair and try to breathe. We gotta call the cops, like right now. Shit, Callum says. This guy doesn't work alone, you know. When your face is on the news, then what? I want to call the cops and get the fuck out of here as much as you do, trust me, but we have to think a minute. I blow out a hard breath and go pick up the beer I was drinking and gulp it down. Shit, shit, shit. I try to get a hold of myself. How did you find out who he was? How would you know that? I ask. Anna. Anna, the wife in 203? Someone told her they saw him, like, off someone. Off someone? Like they saw Eddie actually kill a person? Yeah, and she said that it was for a lesser offense than humiliating him in front of everyone at the pool, the way I did, and to watch my back. But you looked him up. The internet isn't gonna tell you he's cartel. So what did you find out that makes you think he's so dangerous? Just that? Could be a rumor. Before he can answer me, I hear a small tap-tap at the office door. His face goes ghostly white, and neither of us move. Cass, a small voice calls, it's Sinatra. I'm here for my happy meal. My hand clasps my heart, and I sit in front of the door and stare across the floor at the back of Eddie's head. A thread of blood trickles down the back of his pale neck. I imagine little Frank walking in and seeing this, and I feel bile push up into my throat. Fuck, I whisper. Who's Sinatra? Callum mouths to me, but I just shake my head. He stays ducked down by the couch in the dim light, and we both stay perfectly still. Cass, I'll take a filet-o-fish or whatever you think. It's okay if you forgot, he says, and now tears stream down my face, and I squeeze my chest with my hand and will myself to stay silent. Okay, sorry. Bye, his little voice says, and then I hear his footsteps down the concrete path until they disappear, and I collapse into my knees. Somehow my crying has morphed into numbness, then white-hot anger. He's dead, Callum whispers. What? Eddie Bacco, he says. Really? Fuck you, I say and leap up. I don't care about maybe potential danger, because this is real danger. Maybe he is tied to bad guys who could behead me. That's a maybe, but I go to prison for sure if I don't call this in right now. Then Callum hands me Eddie's wallet from his pile of things on the coffee table. I mean, Eddie Bacco died 2 years ago murdered, so who the hell is this?